Very good morning, all of you. I am Dr. M.C. Nataraja, professor in the Department of Civil Engineering, Ramaya Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore. At the outset, I welcome all my students for my session 6 for the module 4 on the design of beams. Students, in the previous class, I was discussing about the importances of laterally supported beam, laterally unsupported beam, and also we have seen the various provisions as per IS 800/2007, and also we have seen very meticulously as to how one simply supported problem can be solved. The problem what I discussed in the previous class is on a warehouse having some internal dimension, where we have a series of I-beams kept at some spacing. And over that, an RCC slab has been cast monolithically in such a way that the series of I-beams behaves as if they are laterally supported and restrained. So with that, the provisions that are there in IS 800 has been used, and we have seen the problem. And there we have even seen as to how the total load acting on the beam as a UDL can be calculated based on the given imposed load and also the finish load, and we need to take the self weight of the slab coming onto the beam, and of course with all that load you need to add the self weight of the beam also, and from that consideration the UDL has been calculated, and then the bend moment, shear force, and all those parameters that are needed from the point of design has been done. Let us see today one more problem on a simply supported beam. But here the total load is being given. So if you read the problem, it goes like this. A simply supported beam of span 9 meter. So the span is given here. Please assume the span to be the effective span because he has not given any information about the bearing. And he is subjected to a load of 40 kN per meter. Kindly see 40 kN per meter, which is inclusive of all types of loading. So obviously it is a calculated load from the point of all loads that are acting on the beam. So we have to take this as the total load. But this is the given load. Obviously 40 kN per meter happens to be the working load. Otherwise we would have mentioned the load as the ultimate load or the collapse load or the failure load. And also it has suggested the beam ISMB 450. So that we need to use it. The plastic section modulus may be sufficient or may not be sufficient, that is not known. And also he is telling that we need to design a suitable cover plates also. And that is where the design of the total beam comes into picture. So obviously it is a problem where we need to select I section and also the cover plates. But the I section is already suggested in the problem. Otherwise we have suggested the I section separately. The compression flange of the beam is effectively supported by the floor construction throughout. So that is where restraining the beam from moving in the lateral direction as far as its compression flange is concerned is taken care of. So obviously it is a restrained beam. And also the stiff end bearing width is also given, and that is 75 mm. Otherwise it would have taken around 100 mm. But everything is being given, which I have mentioned in the red color. And also ISMB is suggested, which is really not sufficient, and there is a reason he is asking for the cover plates. So obviously it is a problem where we need to design a built up section consisting of an I section and cover plate. Now let us write down the given values. So it is a laterally supported beam. So the factored load is 1.5 into 40 equal to 60 kN per meter. So 1.5 is the partial safety factor for the load, and of course for the combinations of dead load and live load, and this is what the combination we generally take for conventional buildings. So effective span is also given as 9 meter. Now we need to calculate the bending moment, the design bending moment corresponding to the ultimate load. So that is where WL square by 8 comes into picture as a simply supported beam. So which is 69 square by 8, 607.5 kilonewton meter. So this is what the moment for which we need to select the section. Design shear force is WL by 2. So obviously 60 into 9 by 2 is 270 kilonewton. So this is where the designing the beam for the limit state of collapse against the moment comes into picture. And of course we need to check the selected beam for the shear force. So this is where designing and then checking comes into picture. And of course from the serviceability point of view, we need to check for the deflection as well. Then what is the section modulus required? So we know the section modulus is given by this formula because the ultimate moment is equal to plastic section modulus into Fy, and of course that need to be divided by gamma mo, which is the material safety factor. So the material safety factor is 1.1 in steel. So Zp about the horizontal axis. So that axis is represented as Z, so being the major principal axis, so which is the symmetric axis about which the second moment of area is maximum. So if we calculate, so from this formula, so we get the answer as 2.673 into 10 to the power of 6 mm cube. So section modulus is in mm cube. So if you convert this into centimeter cube, it is 2673, for which we need to select the section from the IS code or from the steel table, and you can also refer IS 800 for selecting the sections. Now in the current problem, my dear friends, if you see, he has already suggested the beam, and if you see what is the Zp of that beam, the Zp of the beam is always be smaller, and probably the Zp may vary about 40% or 60% of the required section modulus. So the required section modulus is around 2670, and obviously we need to select an I section for about 50 to 60% of Z. That is what we would have done it, but otherwise in the present problem I section is given. So obviously we can see whether the plastic section modulus of the given I section is more than the section modulus Zp Z required. It is not so, it is in fact substantially less. That we will be seeing in the next slide. So obviously it is a case of design of two cover plates, one at top and one at bottom, and that's what the problem is. Now kindly say, what is the plastic section modulus of the given beam? So the given beam is ISMB 450, and of course the weight of the beam is also known, and you can refer in steel table as to what is the plastic section modulus of this beam about the major axis of bending. So it is about 1533 centimeter cube. But we need to select a section for 2673. So obviously the suggested ISMB is not sufficient to carry the design moment which is resulting from the loads on the beam. So obviously we can calculate as to what is the Zp that is to be provided by the two cover plates. So we have to subtract the two values, so one value from the other one. So that is where 2673 minus 1533 comes into picture, and that is equal to 1139. So close to 1140 is what the additional plastic section modulus required, and for that we need to suggest two plates. Friends, so kindly see, out of 2673, so the I section is having about 1500. So 1500 compared to 2673 roughly, so it is about 50 to 60%, and if you subtract one from the other, so the balance is about 1139, maybe about 40% of the required Z for which you need to suggest the cover plates. And also in one of the earlier classes we have derived the expression for the area of the cover plates. So from the area of the cover plates, we can calculate the thickness for the assumed width, or if you have certain width being assumed, and we can also determine the thickness. And we have seen that the area of the cover plates is given by the section modulus required for the cover plate divided by the depth of the section. So depth of the section selected, as you know, it is 450. So Zp required is what has been calculated just above. So the same thing I have written it here, of course into 10 to the power of 3 to convert centimeter to mm, divided by 450 being the designation, ISMB 450 being the depth. So area is 2550 34. And we need to identify certain thickness. Let us assume the thickness as 12 mm, and this thickness should be approximately comparable to the thickness of the flange of the section. So generally the thickness less than about 10 mm is not provided. So you can start with 10 mm and 12 mm and then determine the width and check whether the width is sufficient. If the width is less than the width of the flange of the I section, you need not to worry. Even if it is equal to, no problem. It can be more than the width of the flange. So when it is more, it should not be too wide, where the projection of the plate beyond the edge of the flange should not be too much. So that is where 5 times the thickness of the flange as a projection comes into picture, and about 50 mm in excess of the width of the flange on either side. So 100 mm extra over and above the width of the flange can be accommodated, and still we need to do some secondary checks, and that is where I have assumed 12 mm as the thickness of the cover plate, and from that width of the cover plate is calculated as. So this is what the area determined from ZP of the plate by 12 being the thickness, it is 211. So that can be rounded off to 220. So in fact we have Indian standard plates and flats of this dimension. So as a Indian standard flat having a width of 22 centimeter or 220 mm having a thickness of 12, so you get some standard length, but what is needed is to cover the required span of the beam, and of course some extension that has to go over the support. So exactly equal to the length of the original beam ISMB 450, we need to have two cover plates, one at top and one at bottom. And kindly see the formula what we have used. So ZP of the cover plate by depth, Z of plate by D or H of the beam, that gives the area of each cover plate. So there is a reason what I have calculated is for one cover plate, and you simply mention that we need two plates of that dimension which you have calculated. Now this is how finally your built up section looks like. So this is what the selected section. So the width is slightly more here. So the width of the flange of the I section is about 150, but the selected plate has a width of 220. So 220 minus of 150, if we calculate, so it is 70 and by 2. So this is what the projection. So up to 50 mm of projection is not a problem, as long as you have a thickness of about 10 mm and more for the plate. So even with this, so this particular plate is not going to bend downwards, it is not going to curl, and there is no buckling of the projecting part of the extra plate. So this is one additional check that need to be done, but as long as the projection is very small, about 30, 40, 50 mm, so that is not a problem, and the secondary requirements are being taken care of. Now from the steel table for the given ISMB, so thickness of the flange is 17.4 mm, web thickness 9.4 mm, and this is what you get straight away from IS 800 also, but this information of the radius at the root of the junction, you are not going to get it, so that you need to get it only from the steel table. So that is where 15 mm comes into picture, and this information is required from the point of calculation of the effective depth of the web, so that we can make a classification as to whether the web is plastic or compact and things like that. So D is equal to H minus of 2, we have seen. So we need to subtract 2 times the thickness of the flange and 2 times the R1. So that's where the formula is like that. So 450 minus of 2 into, so 17.4 thickness of flange plus the radius what we have selected from the table. So that is 15 mm. So with that, 385.2 is what the prismatic depth of the web. Overall depth minus of this is what the depth of the flange including the fillet, not only at the top and but also at the bottom, and that is being referred to as H2 in the steel table, and that H2 is required in the check as far as the web crippling or the crimping is concerned. It is not needed for the web buckling. So with this the plastic section modulus Kindly see here, as far as the high section is concerned, so this is selected from the table 1533, and the elastic section modulus also has been considered here. So just for curiosity, and also we can make out what is the difference if you divide ZPZ by ZEZ. So that is where the shape factor of the high section comes into picture, which is approximately close to 1.15. Moment of inertia with respect to the horizontal axis, major principal axis being the symmetric axis, that is 30390.8, so 30,390 into 10 to the power of 4. So this information is needed for the deflection check. So we will be calculating the deflection corresponding to the working load, and we have the formula, and where in the denominator we have the flexural rigidity EI, where I is the moment of inertia with respect to the horizontal axis, and sometimes we take that axis as XX, but as per the code it is ZZ, and you need not to worry much. Now let us go to the classification of the section. As for the flange is concerned, we know we need B, so that is breadth of the flange by 2, and that breadth is 150, so obviously 150 by 2 is 75 mm. As a function of this projecting part of the flange from the center, dividing that by the thickness of the flange, so we have the 75 upon 17.4 4.3, that is obviously less than 9.4 epsilon, so epsilon being 1, because it is under the root of 250 upon the yield stress 250 fy, so that is where epsilon is 1. If you have a steel of any other grade, so what is this limiting value of the width to thickness, so that will vary, and that can be addressed with the help of this epsilon under the root of 250 by the yield stress of the material. So therefore the web is the flange is plastic. What about the web? So as far as the web is concerned, we need to determine what is that prismatic depth, the thickness of the web, which is constant over certain height. So that has to be calculated like this. So this is what we have already exercised. So that is 385.2, so this is much less than the overall depth of the beam, so that is about 450 mm depth. So from 450 mm, so this has been calculated. So from this the aspect ratio of the element, so the width to the thickness or depth to the thickness in this particular case, so 385.2 upon 9.4, so 40.9, and this is substantially less compared to 84, almost half. The section is plastic. Now kindly see here, whether you check the flange or the web, the required value, the limiting value from the point of classification to plastic is 9.4 epsilon as far as flange is concerned, and 84 epsilon as far as web is concerned, but the actual ratio is substantially less, and almost 50% less. And definitely the entire cross section is plastic, because both flange and web are plastic. But the message here is that in case of a normal situation where the beam is used over a conventional span of 6 to 8 meters, as long as it is a short span to medium span and not a very long span beam, so the classification of the section is such that it is always be plastic, so that plastic carrying capacity will be able to get it, provided the depth of the beam is not so deep, so where it is somewhat shallow in depth. If you go for a bigger size beam where the depth is larger, where it acts as a girder or a plate girder, so where web might become compact or sometimes semi-compact, so that is where we need to look for the buckling effect. And of course that can also be addressed because in the formula for the moment carrying capacity, so we can directly or indirectly consider those things because we'll be introducing one beta factor over there that will take care of. So with this classification of section as plastic, so now you need not to worry. And by chance, if the beam is also analyzed by plastic method, and as long as you are giving this high section, then really the plastic hinge is going to come at the point where the bending moment is maximum. So this is a simply supported beam. One plastic hinge is sufficient. The hinge forum and the hinge also undergo continuous rotation leading to collapse, and corresponding to that collapse So what is the moment carrying capacity? So that's where the forum lying limit state is considered. Now let us see what is the shear force. The shear force is 270, but what is the capacity? Because already we have designed for moment, we know the section, we also know the area of the web resisting the shear. So here V should be less than or equal to VD. So this is where satisfying the limit state from the consideration of shear comes into picture. V less than or equal to VD is what the limit state equation. So V is 270, that is what we have applied as a reaction. But VD, so from the point of selected suction, so Vn upon gamma MO. So what is that Vn? So the Vn is the actual resistance of the beam. So from the point of its area, HTW, and that need to be multiplied with Fy, so that we are going to get the shear force, but that need to be divided by gamma MO. So to take care of the partial safety factor effect, to address the uncertainties. So that's where so Fy upon gamma MO comes into picture. And also see the Fy is further divided by root 3, because Fy upon root 3 is the octahedral shear stress, and in fact it is a shear stress from the which causes the yielding of the web, and where Fy is actually the stress to be determined from the tension test. So Fy is the yield stress corresponding to tension, but here we need the yield stress in shear. Fy by root 3 comes into picture. So anyway, all these things we have discussed in the earlier classes. When you substitute all the relevant values, thickness of the web is 9.4, h 450, so 250 is the yield stress, and of course in the denominator we have the corresponding values divided by 1000, because the answer you are going to get in Newton, so it is 555 kilonewton, and this is substantially more compared to 270. So the shear actually coming as a reaction. So when you calculate 60% of this, 60% of 555 approximately, so it is 300 and odd, but what is applied is 270, so definitely it is a case of low shear. So this is where the importance of low shear comes into pictures, and that's what I am checking here in this slide. So 0.6 VD is 333, so 333 is still more compared to V270 applied as a shear, and definitely the shear is not going to have any influence on the moment carrying capacity. So obviously the section is such that the full plastic capacity can be realized with the selected section, even though we have some area of the web being utilized for the shear. But if substantial area of the web is being utilized, then definitely 0.6 of VD is definitely less compared to what the shear has a reaction. So in such situation, so we need to go for a higher suction. So that type of problem, if time permits, we'll be seeing in the subsequent classes. But otherwise, in a general situation, more or less it is a low shear case. V less than 0.6 of VD, so we need not to worry about modifying the section, low shear case. Now we have seen beta B equal to 1 from the point of plastic section. So this is where checking the moment carrying capacity of the section comes into picture. Here we need to consider 2 ZP. So 1 ZP of the selected I section. This is already selected, is already suggested in the problem. So that is where ZP of the I section comes into picture, plus ZP of the cover plate. So we have already selected the 2 cover plates, and what exactly the actual ZP. In fact, the size of the cover plate is calculated from the consideration of what is the ZP required for the plate. And in fact, we have slightly increased the cross-sectional area also. So when we round off either the width or the thickness, then we normally round off to the higher value. So with that, the ZP of the plate available will be definitely be more. So we need not to even do this check, because it is obvious that so ZP of the I section plus plate will always be more than what the ZP that is required. But anyway, so as a formality, so we need to do this check and see that so we have a substantial value of ZP over the major axis. So ZP of the cover plate, so area of the cover plates by 2 into the distance of the centroid of the plate with respect to the centroid of the I section. That is where the horizontal centroidal axis is passing. and of course another value with respect to the bottom, y bottom. So y top plus y bottom, so 450 by 2, so this is where half the depth of the I section comes into picture. But the center of the plate, because plate is kept above the flange whose thickness is 12 mm, so about 6 mm additionally comes into picture. So that is where the depth of the top plate, and similarly we have the depth from the bottom plate also. So that is 231. So obviously, so ZP of the cover plate is equal to, so kindly say, so 2 into 220 into 12. What is this 220 into 12? So this is the area of one plate, and of course area of the two plates, and divided by 2 means it is just area of one plate and the distance between the center to centroidal axis of the two plates. So that is where 231 plus 231 comes into picture, and finally with that ZP of the plate is 1219. So this value need to be added to the ZP of the I section, and that value should be more than the ZP that is required to carry that moment which is resulting from the load that is coming on the I section. So with this the design moment of the section including the plate is equal to, so I've added those two values of the ZP, of course into 10 to the power of 3 to convert centimeter cube to mm cube, into 250 being the yield stress divided by 1.1, so to convert the characteristic yield strength to design strength, and then what is the value in terms of kilonewton meter. So I have divided the entire thing by 10 to the power of 6. So with that the answer is 630 kilonewton meter, and this is definitely more than 607.5. Now if you see, there is a small difference between these two things, because when we selected the plate we have slightly modified the width, so we wanted a slightly lesser width, and that has been rounded off to 220. So if the 220 is not available in the market, probably you may be going for 230. So in that process, so there may be a slight increase in the moment carrying capacity, so there is always be onto the safer side, but it should not be substantially more also, otherwise it becomes slightly uneconomical. So now the design of the beam with plates from the consideration of moment is okay. Now let us do the check for the deflection. So the maximum deflection for the simply supported beam with UDL is given by, so this formula, 5 upon 384 WL to the power 4 divided by EIZZ or XX. So this is actually the major moment of inertia. So this is the span of the beam in mm. Everything we need to substitute in mm and newton. So taking the load W kilonewton per meter, that is equal to 40 newton mm. So no change. So what we need is IXX. So IXX of the I section can be selected from the steel table, but mind you, so we also have two plates, and those two plates also will contribute to the moment of inertia. So we need to calculate the moment of inertia of both the plates about their centroidal axis, and that value need to be transferred onto the centroidal axis of the entire cross section. So that is where the parallaxis theorem comes into picture. Transformation of moment of inertia of the plate onto the central section comes into picture. That's where area into h square. So if you recollect the problems which you have done in strength of material or in engineering mechanics, so the same concept we need to use it here also. So this IZZ of I section, so you can get it from the steel table. This is what the value. So this is in centimeter to the power 4 into 10 to the power of 4. And 2 into, because there are two plates, so for the plate about its own axis, so even if you go back, I'm kindly say, so this is where B, D, D is the thickness, so B, D, cube, BD cube by 12, the center is somewhere here, area into H square, so this is what the height, and that need to be squared. The entire thing should be multiplied by 2 to take care of the bottom plate. So this is what we need to do, so that we will be able to get the additional moment of inertia because of the plates. So that is where 220 into 12 cube by 12 for one plate about its own axis plus area into 231 square, the transformed effect of the area, the whole thing into 2, so because there are 2 plates. So with this, so it is 585.72 into 10 to the power of 6 mm to the power of 4. So because everything has been calculated in terms of mm4, kindly see here also we have multiplied with 10 to the power of 4, even though this is centimeter to the power of 4. So everything is in mm, so therefore the deflection is 5 into 40. So kindly see here it is 40, the working stress, working load, not the ultimate load, into 9000 to the power 4 being the span, 384 into, so whatever you have here, E, 2 into 10 to the power of 5 megapascal. So this value, straight away you put it here. So with this calculation, it is 29.17. And the allowable value, so this is again available in your steel code, IS-800, span by 300. So this is not 1/300, so this is span by 300. So 9000/300, this is 30 mm. So the calculated value is 29, so the allowable is 30 mm, so definitely the beam is safe. Now here the beam is safe, but the values are so close, so by chance if you get a value like 30, 30.2, 30.3, it is marginally unsafe, but still so you can go with the same beam as the final beam from the point of suggestion in practice. But if there is a too much of a difference, the calculated value is 32, 34, 35, but allowable value is 30, you really cannot take the risk. But in such cases, it is better you increase the thickness of the plate. Instead of 12 mm, if you make it to even 14 mm, because the area becomes 220 into 40. So 220 into 12 and 220 into 14 may not be a substantial increase in area, but if you see the transformed effect of the area to the centroidal axis of the entire section, so that is a substantial value. So with that, so the value what you are going to get for the plate, the IZ increases tremendously. So instead of 585, you definitely will get a value close to something like 600, 620. When that comes in the denominator, so your deflection decreases substantially. So a small increase in thickness in plate, so you'll be able to take care of. So at least 2 mm of increase in plate we have to make. Now let us see the check for the web buckling. So this is also discussed in detail in the previous problem also. So this is where the web buckling, as a column the web buckles. So you know the slenderness ratio, in fact 2.45 into D by thickness of the web. So what is D? That is clearly given here. So depth over the fillet, not the depth over the flange. So overall depth, depth over the flange, and this is depth over the fillet. So that is the value that has been already calculated. So kindly see, so taking 45 degree dispersion with respect to the center beyond the edge of the stiff bearing plate. So if you recollect the formula, the way we have derived, so we need h by 2, so 225. So stiff bearing width is also 75. So put that value here. So b1 is 220. This is the stiff bearing width, so 75. So the dispersion value is 225, thickness of the web, and of course this is what the stress we need to calculate from the consideration of column buckling, and the slenderness ratio of the web is needed. So we have a formula something like this, so this can be remembered, or even the simplified formula. So substituting all the values, D is 385.2, so that is what this depth calculated in the section classification. So root of 12/9.4, it is 99.4. So my dear friends, kindly see here, so this is where we need to select the stress looking to IS-800 in the limit state for compression. So all those details you must have used it in the analysis and design of compression members. We have different curves available for selecting this particular stress, and also we have different imperfection factors, the buckling classification of A, B, C, D. So if you recollect those things here, the buckling classification of C with that imperfection factor needed to be considered. So let us go straight away to the code IS-800, where we have a table that will give you the strength in this particular column at which the onset of column buckling starts. for corresponding to this 99.4. So this is where it is close to 100. In fact, no, what is that operation of calculating the exact value? Interpolation. So probably the interpolation also can be avoided, almost equal to 100. So with that, so kindly see the reference IS 800-2007, the table 9C. So that gives the design compressive stress after accounting for the column buckling. So the classification of the buckling curve is C, and the grade of the steel is 250. So once again, I will tell you what is the minimum grade with which FY can start. In our country, it is 200, 210, 220, and now this is 400, and it can go even up to 540. So please see all these things. And in case you need a steel of higher grade, so you need to speak to the manufacturer, and that particular grade can be procured. So all many of these grades may not be available. So that's where we need to check what are all the usual grades of steel that are available in the open market. So before you take design of such type of structures, especially in practice. So under this yield stress 250, so corresponding to this slenderness ratio, kindly see this K into L by R, non-dimensional slenderness ratio, 90, 100, 110. As the slenderness ratio increases, I am starting from 90, 121, for 100, 107, for 110, it is 94, it is decreasing. So as the slenderness ratio increases, so the stress also decreases. But the corresponding value of the buckling stress for any slenderness ratio keep on increases as the grade of the steel increases. So that is quite obvious. So for 100 exactly, it is 107. But in this case, the slenderness ratio is slightly less than 100. So probably it is slightly to the slenderness ratio of 90. So don't think that it is also less, because as the slenderness ratio increases, the stress decreases. So 121 to 107, close to 107, but towards 121, but less by a marginal value. So about 106 point something is what the interpolated value. Otherwise, we can also round it off and take it as 107 corresponding to slenderness ratio of 100. So that is what the calculation I have done here. So kindly see, so it is very close to 107.84. So slightly more than that, because it is going towards the higher value. So put the bearing width 75. So this is 225. So into 9.4 is what the thickness. So the remaining thing, what we have calculated in the forum block. So kindly see that. So FC. So this is what the stress that need to be substituted. So that is what the stress, 107.87. So dividing that by 1000 or multiplying with 10 to the power of minus 3, so you get the allowable strength of the web from the point of column buckling, 304.1 kilonewton, but you are applying only 270 kilonewton as a reaction generating from the loads acting on the beam. So obviously the resistance of the beam is so high, so obviously your shear of 270 is not going to cause any problem, so your web is definitely safe. Now let us see the another check from the consideration of the crippling. So more or less the same type of formula we have, but here we need to use the yield stress in crippling, but whereas in the buckling, so stress based on the slenderness ratio comes into picture, and that is always be less than the yield stress. But here we will be putting the yield stress, because crippling causes the crimping effect. So that is where the departure of the junction in the form of a flow comes into picture. So this is where the yielding comes into picture, localized yielding. So these values you know. So what is this N2 is very important. So B1 is known, the strip bearing width. N2 is 2.5 times the combined thickness of the flange and the radius at the junction. So 17.4 plus 15 into that 2.5, it is 81. So N1 is 81 because it is a single dispersion. So kindly remember, because you are checking the secondary effect at the support, so where the dispersion is onto one side towards the beam. But if it is an intermediate beam anywhere along the span as a concentrated load, so then we'll be having two dispersion, so onto two sides. So that is where two times of this N2, not only here, even in the other case of buckling, needed to be considered. So put this value here and then see what is the total force that really causes the crippling. So stick bearing width plus the calculated value of 81, so that is where the width multiplied by the thickness, so that is where the area of the web which is susceptible for this crimpling effect, and the stress that causes the crimpling is 250 upon 1.1 to get the design stress, and we have 333.27 which is greater than 270. So if you really want to have a crimpling, so you need to have 333 as a reaction, but you are putting hardly 270. So 270 resulting from the load as a reaction is not going to cause any crimpling. So this is where your section, selected section, is safe against crimpling. So ISMB 450 with two cover plates, 220 mm into 12 mm on either side of the flange is okay, not only from the consideration of bending moment but also from the consideration of shear as a check, and of course safe against the serviceability requirement against deflection, and also from the local failure behavior of web buckling and web crippling. So with this, the design is completed, section is definitely safe. Now we need to go for the designs. So the design, we need to go for the design of connection. So the connection design can be done by welding or maybe by bolting. So you need to provide the welding all along the length of the bay connecting the flange and the cover plate at this junction of the overhang and the edge of the flange, and that will become an intermittent weld. Otherwise, if you are providing a bolted connection, so we need to have a hole being drilled here, and one bolt can be provided onto one side, and onto the other side also you can have one, or maybe a combination of 2+2 means along one line you have either 2 or 4. If it is 2, one in the other side. If it is 4, 2 on either side. So like that, one row at the top and similarly one row at the bottom. So if you design for one side, the same configuration can be extended for the other side. Now what really happens when the beam bends, you please try to recollect. So the beam bends and we have a curvature, and obviously the top plates has a tendency of getting separated. So because of enormous shear between the flange and the cover plate. So that's what normally happens. You can appreciate this type of a thing to happen. So when the beam is bending and there is no connection between the flange and the cover plate, so definitely cover plate simply slides off. So that's where the shear effect comes into picture, but that should not undergo separation. It should behave as a sort of combined element. So that's where a monolithic way of the behavior of the two elements comes into picture, and for that particular shear we need to design the connection, and that shear is acting at the junction like this. So kindly see the shear here, and similarly we have the shear acting at the bottom also. And if you recollect the formula from the strength of material or even from the engineering mechanics, if you have done it, so this is what the formula. So the vertical shear and the first moment of area at that section, either to the top or to the bottom. So let us take it to the top where we have only the plate. So that is where VAY bar by BIZ comes into picture. So with this we will be able to calculate the shear strength for which the connection is to be designed between the two plates, for the two plates, and the shear between the two elements. So 270 into 10 to the power of 3 is what the shear, the area of the plate, 220 into 12, and upon, so we have taken the unit width of the section and IZ, so that has already been calculated. So this is where the IZ of the combined section comes into picture. In fact, this IZ we have already calculated and used in the deflection calculation. So that value has to be brought here. And what is this 231? So that is the center of the entire cross section, the centroid, and of course this particular distance, the center where the force is assumed to be concentrated. So that is 231. So with this, we are going to get 280.5 newton being the shear strength available between the junction that causes the separation, and we don't want the separation to happen, and we need to provide the bolts, necessary number of bolts or even the weld, so that the entire shear force of 280 is being taken by that fastener, being the weld or the bolt. So let us provide two rows of bolts at a pitch of P, and force in each bolt need to be equated to half into SH into P. So what is that SH? SH is what the shear of the shear across the section, and the pitch is what need to be equated to 280.5. So if everything is known, so you can calculate what is this pitch. So of SH into P. So let us see how to calculate this in the next section. Now if you have a bolted section, so assuming some number, some diameter of the bolt 16 mm, hole diameter is 18 mm, so we know there is a formula, because here it is a case of single shear and we are considering only one bolt, and either you can use the left formula or the right formula depending on whether the thread comes along the shear plane or not. So I have assumed the thread to be available along the shear plane. So with that, so Fu is 400 for the given material. So NS equal to 1, because 1 bolt, NN is equal to 0. So this is what the area of the bolt, because I need the net area, so into 0.78. So it is 201 mm². So this is where the shear strength of one bolt in single shear. So 37 kN. And maybe your teacher must have told you, for certain diameters of the bolt, we need to assume the probable values of the shear as a single shear case or as a double shear case. And also sometimes we need to remember the range of values for the bearing also. So let us see what is the bearing value for the bolt. So we have a formula like this from IS 800. So we need to calculate the constant KB. So that can be calculated from these three values suggested in the code. And finally, with all these calculations, your KB will be 0.65. So the minimum of all the values. So I'm not going into the greater details. In fact, I'm just explaining in a hurry, because after the discussion of all these things only, so the chopper on beam comes into picture. So otherwise it becomes a repetition. So in an online class like this, too much of deliberation on the topic which has already been covered is not needed. So it is 0.65. So putting the KB as 0.65, and of course we also have what is DTFU divided by gamma MB. So kindly see these values and substitute here 2.5 into 0.65 into 1. So this is where the thickness, so kindly see here the depth. So this is, sorry, this is the diameter of the bolt, I'm sorry. So thickness and FU. What is the thickness? The thickness is 12 mm. So it is either the thickness of the plate or the thickness of the flange, whichever is minimum. So that's where 12 mm comes into picture. So this is the diameter of the bolt. So ultimate strength of the bolt into 1.25. So this is where partial safety factor for the bolt comes into picture. So this is 1.5 from IS 800. So the answer is 99.84. Obviously the bearing value is always be higher in case of single shear case. So single shear is 37. Obviously the bolt value is governed by the shear, and that is 37. What we need to do is the formula what we have of into SH into P, that should be equal to bolt value. Pitch is not known. SH we have calculated the shear, so there is a formula. So from that, equated to bolt value, so we can calculate what is pitch. So pitch is 264.89. So the bolt of 16 mm diameter on either side of the web for each of the flange along the entire length of the web, so we need to put the bolts at 26 cm, 264 mm center to center, and finally check whether this pitch is satisfies the other requirements. So we have the requirement of pitch because it is in the compression side. The next one is on the tension side. So we have the pitch, it should not be more than 12 times the thickness. So that's where 144 comes into picture, thickness of the plate, otherwise 200 mm. So whichever is minimum is what we need to take. So obviously, so you can give an appropriate pitch. Now similarly, so the pitch as far as the tension side is concerned, instead of 12 times the thickness, it will be 16 times the thickness. So then it will become 192. So comparing all these things, so if you can provide something which can satisfy all these things, so in the tension, so it can be 180, because 192 is what the value that controls. So 180 can be given. Of course, the required value is 264, but the minimum requirement governs the design in this case. But if your shear is too much, the required value can be like 80, 90, 100, and the design value of the pitch governs in that case. But here the pitch is so large because not much of a shear between the junction causing the separation. So in the compression side, a sort of a closure pitch, but in the tension side, slightly a larger pitch comes into picture. And with this this problem from the point of design completely, including the connection by bolt, so has been done. And finally, we can also draw the cross section, which looks something like this, and this is the end of the problem number 2. Incomplete, we have discussed this particular problem. So now if students are interested, they can also take up the connection design from the point of welding. So that can be considered as an exercise problem, and many such problems are being discussed in S.K. Dugal textbook. We also see some problems in Subramaniam textbook also, and try to practice and appreciate the procedures. So friends, I will just take up the last problem. I will just rush through the problem, because this problem is also very similar to the previous two problems, but I will not be going in detail as far as the various steps are concerned. I will just discuss the importance of this problem just in a few minutes. The span is 7 meters, as you can make out. Of course, there is an RCC floor that has to be there because the beam is laterally supported, otherwise it becomes unsupported, and that type of problems are not there from the examination point of view, clearly mentioned in the syllabus. And also kindly see, so this is I have made it as 7 meters. There's a small mistake, my dear friends. So in the formula, the span I have substituted is 6 meter. Kindly see, it is 6 meter. In the problem also it is given as 6 meter, but in the figure I have represented that as 7 meter. So that small mistake, so kindly rectify yourself. So there is a UDL, but factored 60 kilonewton per meter, and of course we have a central concentrated load of 150 kilonewton. So this is similar to the previous problem, but only thing is we have a additional concentrated load, but factored, that need to be considered. So your bending moment, it gets increased because of the point load effect, and similarly the shear effect also increases because of that factored concentrated load. So what is the formula from the point of bending moment? So WL square by 8 as far as UDL is concerned, and WL by 4 for point load. So they're all the factors, so I am not further amplifying. So 495 kilonewton meter is what the design bending moment for which you need to select the section. You can either select an individual section like the problem number 1, or you can also even look for designing a built-up section where 50% of the resistance may be given by the beam and rest by the plates. So in any combinations of such the parameters can be looked at. Now kindly see the plastic section modulus required. So it is 2178. So now we need to select a section from IS456. So you please exercise this, and this is what ISMB 550 I am selecting. Now so kindly see the information available from the code. Put all these things, calculate this D from the point of classification of the section. So it is 475. So the plastic section modulus of the selected section is much higher than what is required. So elastic modulus also, I am just putting it here because it is required from the point of secondary check. And moment of inertia is also required, so this is for deflection check. So the section classification in both cases it is satisfied, so it is a plastic section. And the required moment of resistance, so kindly see here, so this is where the factored self-weight of the beam, a small additional thing that also comes into picture, if required that can be added to the bending moment from the given load, otherwise that can be neglected also, not a big difference. So again, what is needed is 2209, but we have given much more, 2711, so it is okay from the point of bending moment. So again, so I collected the shear force from the given UDL WL by tau. The point load is 150 by tau. And of course, a small contribution from the self weight of the selected section can be considered or neglected. So it is 258. But if you see the shear resistance of the beam which you have already selected from the consideration of moment, so the resistance is 808, very high value compared to the reaction 258. So 0.6 of this 808 is 484, very high, but what we are applying is less. So again, it is a low shear case. So classification of the section, we have already done that. So D by TW, it is 42.44, less than 67 epsilon. So this check, I don't know whether I have done it in the previous problem. This is needed only to tell you that your web is not going to undergo shear buckling. So as long as this ratio is less than 67, so you can safely presume that there is no buckling problem. And also we have used this in the section classification because this is less than 84, and thereby the section is also plastic, and at the same time, so the shear buckling is not happening. So with this, the MD, if you recalculate it, so it is 616, far greater than the required value, so it is okay. And from the secondary consideration of elastic section modulus, so corresponding to the first yield, so MD should be less than or equal to 1. Even if you do this check, so that check is also satisfied. So from the bending consideration at the plastic, and also from the bending consideration in order to avoid the shear buckling of the web, so that it is also safe under the elastic condition. So both have been considered in this approach, and your problem is okay. So check for deflection as usual. So this is from the contribution of the UDL, and this is from the contribution of the concentrated load. Kindly see the formula, WL cube by 48EI for the point load, and the same W5WL4 by 384EI. So substitute all the values, and actual value is 5.34, but the allowable is L by 320 mm, so it is safe. So similarly, so you can do the check for the buckling. So slenderness ratio as a column of for the web, 102. It is in fact same as very close to 100 what we got it for the previous problem. Your stress is very close to 100, so that's what we have seen. So multiply with that formula. So 405 is what the force that can cause the buckling, but we are hardly applying 258, so there is no web buckling or the vertical buckling or the column buckling of the web. So similarly, the last check from the point of web bearing, so this is the bearing width, stiff bearing width plus additional, taking 1:2.5 slope as far as the dispersion line is concerned. So we have taken the stiff width as 75, 2.5 times of the combined thickness of flange and the radius at the root. With that, it is 93.25, and putting that value, multiplying with thickness of the web 11.2, so you have the area operated on 250 being the stress causing the yielding by 1.1, so that you can get the design yield stress in divided by further 1000, so you have 428 kilonewton more than 258. So we need 428 kilonewton so that there is a real yielding of the junction starts as a crippling, but what we are applying is hardly 258, and in fact there is no crippling. So the problem what we have considered here, the both the problem, they are safe from moment, safe from shear, safe from deflection, and of course from the two lateral effects also it is safe. So thereby, whatever the designs we have done is okay, friends. So I will conclude at this stage that we have almost come to the end of the beam, except one small unit where we need to discuss about some connections. So with that one class, so we are completing this module 5. So if you have any questions, you can ask. Thank you very much. Wish you all the best.